especially for you who are who may not have been with the movement for a long time, because we're going to be dealing with some topics which may seem rather abstruse, rather remote from the down-to-earth realities of what's going on today. But my general way of presenting these matters I find it's more successful to present them in a somewhat whimsical way, because otherwise people get too serious about these matters and sort of lose the point. Because we're going to be talking about music, but also about how the universe is organized at the same time. I always like to start with Lyndon LaRouche, because certainly this movement wouldn't be anywhere without him, and we wouldn't be working on these issues. And frankly, if it weren't for the work that he has done and the kind of influence that he's generated amongst a very small handful of artists, classical artists today. Classical art would already be dead right now. It would be gone. We wouldn't have classical art. Now, of course, some of you say, well, what's classical art? I mean, it's dead. It's been dead for 200 years, right? You have romantic art, and you have post-romantic art, and modern art, and postmodern art, and so forth. But the purpose of classical is something sort of very special, and it's something that even most classical musicians don't really realize, and many of them, when you bring it up, they get very hot under the collar, and you find that sometimes the classical musicians are some of the hardest people to organize around the issues of classical music, because it's like a bureaucrat who's been sitting in his office for 50 years, and they've got a certain way of thinking about things, and don't tell me any different. But I want to start with a couple of things that Lynn said. This is in this recent paper that he wrote, Britain's Bernard Lewis and His Crimes, which is in the Monday briefing. And he says, on the matter of the higher implications of the Creator's nature, the best evidence of scientific knowledge is that the solar planetary system was generated as a higher form of existence by a young, fast-spinning sun. God's universe, is that as the solar planetary system was generated as a higher form of existence by a young, fast-spinning sun, God's universe is not fixed, is never entropic. Entropic means it winds down, which means that it needs somebody else outside to come in and drop from the sky or come up from the floorboards and wind it back up again. As Mr. LaRouche likes to say, the little green men under the floorboards of reality coming up and winding up the universe and then scurrying back underneath the floorboards. Right. Well, this is talking about the universe as a whole. Okay, this is talking about the nature of the universe.
That's been described by Einstein, by Newton, all who have their own different realities.
Well, they're attempting to describe the real, the way the universe actually works. And the actual workings of the universe. And this can be shown actually by the development of humanity itself, is a inherently anti-entropic phenomenon, something which bothers a lot of people who follow Newton, because Newton argued that the universe is generally winding down and requires somebody every once in a while to come and wind it back up. He calls that winder God. Right, so therefore, people say Newton is a God-believing man, but Newton's God is a dictator who comes up, and from time to time is actually impotent most of the time. can't do anything. And then he comes in from the outside, and then he winds everything up, and then he scurries back away, and then lets things wind down again. Right? The and there was a very famous debate, and I if you want to look at that debate, it's really a fascinating debate, which was between an acolyte or a follower of Newton. It may have been Newton himself, a guy named Clark, Samuel Clark, who had a big debate with the main opponent of that idea, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. And these are a series of letters. It's not that long. It can be read, but it takes a lot of concentration. Where the big debate was exactly this, is what is the nature of the universe? And Leibniz, who was a follower of the Christian humanist tradition, and you might call it the Greek tradition, the Greek Platonic tradition, and also the Augustinian tradition, right, argued that no, indeed, right, God is effective and active in the universe all the time, at every point in the universe, because God is not an anthropomorphic entity. It's not a big grandfather in the sky who's sitting and watching and sort of laughing at human beings as they're acting so stupid, and then every once in a while comes down to help them out. And except, you know, then you have people, of course, who want to make a deal with the guy, and they say, you know, please, you know, do something for me, and I'll do something for you. And so you've got deals, right? That's what most of the Christian fundamentalists are involved with right now, right? Making a deal with God. I got a better deal than you do. So that's. But Leibniz argues no, that God is active at every point in the universe through principles, and you can call him God, and you can call him the creator, or the creative principle, or the principle of creation. Right? And that these principles are things which cannot be touched, they cannot be felt, they cannot be heard, although their presence it can be proven through things that are perceptible to us, since those are the only tools that we have in order to be able to validate things that we're thinking. Our thoughts, of course, are things that you also cannot touch and feel. You cannot feel a thought. You cannot put your hand on it. But these thoughts can actually be validated through a proper way, proper dealing with sense perceptions. And that indeed touches on this question of what music is all about, properly looked at. Anyway, let me finish this little paragraph about that Mr. LaRouche wrote. So he says, God's universe is not fixed, is never entropic. And he's arguing against Newton, who says exactly the opposite. But is always anti-entropic, always working to develop and expand into higher states of existence. Mankind's essential mission is to act in the likeness of the Creator and companion of that Creator in this way. Accordingly, we must approach the management of the affairs of the universe in a manner which is governed by a careful blending of certainties and humilities. Now, what does he mean by that? He means that at a certain point, we are certain of certain kinds of principles. However, as the apostle said, we see through a glass darkly, and we cannot see face to face right away. We can only see these principles upon which the universe is organized through these filters. Now, the music, and I use the word classical, but I really just like to use the word music from the standpoint of the way I think about music and the way we're working with it in the movement here, has to do with the way that we organize our social affairs and our mental affairs, both in our own minds and in the way that we communicate with others, in such a way that we can maximize the creative intellectual ferment, both in you know, and propagate that throughout the population in such a way that we can effect a increase in the negative entropy of, first of all, the Earth, but also the universe. That's the purpose of music. It's nothing really less than that. The proof that the truth of music, and music, there is something, you can talk about truth in music as long as you don't think of it as an object, something to be, or a doctrine, something to be set up on a pedestal and worshipped as an object or as an idol. It's not an idol, but truth is a principle of searching for that way of organizing our affairs and the way that we interrelate with each other in such a way that we can affect this kind of renaissance in culture, so that we can also reorganize the economy accordingly. As Lynn and LaRouche has constantly emphasized, you're just by order, you know, even if tomorrow we marched in a whole bunch of people, you know, into the White House, and we got them all to do, and they sat and they read Lyndon LaRouche's program. They went boom, 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 boom. This program, this economic program, and that program. Oh, yeah, okay, we're going to implement this, implement that, and so forth. Hey, yeah, great. It wouldn't work. It would not work. It would fail, right? Because society would not be organized in a way of doing that, right? Because you wouldn't have the proper change of heart in both in the leadership and the population in order to make that occur. These things cannot happen in a way that's mechanical. Political processes are not mechanical. They're dynamic. And when you're dealing with classical music, that's precisely the way classical music operates, is in this dynamic way. That's the thing that bothers a lot of people who are used to repetitive rock music with its beats and its loops, which is most of what rock, pop music, popular music today is loops. I don't know if some of you have ever worked with so-called music software nowadays, but it's just loops. I mean, that's all you're doing. I mean, I read the manuals and so forth. All the new software things, that's all they talk about is a loop. That is, it goes around and then it starts away and then just repeats over and over and over again, unchanged. Unchanged, or maybe you have it every once in a while there's a change, but it's basically creating this kind of background of a repetitive idea, which is ultimately a mind-dulling activity. It's a kind of a mild drug. This kind of repetitiveness in music. Generally, anything that's totally repetitive over and over again is mind-dulling. And the thing about classical music is, properly performed, is that it's never the same. It's always changing, and indeed, even performances of the same work by a great artist will never be the same. And hopefully, the one will be better than the next, as the artist is able to make a more profound. Get a more profound understanding of the ideas in the piece, and also is able to perfect his ability to convey those ideas to the audience. Now, I'm going to talk about an issue in music, which we've been working with here in the movement for a while, implicitly and now explicitly. We've been singing the Jesu meine Freude, which is a piece by Johann Sebastian Bach. How many people have never heard that song? They use them on a Freud. A little bit? Okay. One person hasn't heard it. Okay. Where's our quartet? Or quintet? Come on. Got to do at least the opening. Okay. Just so you have an idea. Okay. Let's just do the chorale. Actually, let's do the Unter deinem Schirm. Let's see if we can do it. Let's see how well it works. Okay? Okay, who's our first prompt? You're going to go first? You don't know by heart yet? Who's doing alto? You're going to do alto? Are you going to do second?
I can do second.
Okay.
You were?
Okay, let's try. Okay. Okay. All right. That's very easy. Sing alto. Ready?
Wohnt in deinem Schimmern, bin ich vor dem Stürmen, alle Feinde frei, lass den Satan bieten,
a little bit, just the idea. That's just one little piece of the larger work that we're working on, the J.S. Bach. It's based on a popular tune, but it's you can see it's quite complex, and there are a lot of different things going on, interactions going on in it. In that, along those lines, Lynn has brought up, Lynn LaRouche has brought up this, there was a question which brought up to Lynn, but he's been working on this question of what he calls the Pythagorean comma. This is an issue in music which has sort of been knocking around for about 20 centuries. And it's one that has always been troublesome, especially for people who liked fixed systems of things, because it's an issue that confronts them with the fact that the universe indeed is not fixed and is a dynamic and self-developing process. And that they don't like that. They want the universe just give me the rules and I'll follow them. That's all. That's all I want. They just don't like it. And we'll get into what it is. I want to read this passage of what Lynn said. This was to a grouping in Germany, I do believe, during his birthday celebrations, right? Mm-hmm. So what was it? Yeah. Right, I think it was during the, birthday dialogue. Yeah, during LaRouche's 84th birthday. And the question was, Lynn, because you're talking about natural beauty and artistic beauty, and when you talked about the Pythagorean comma, and I'll go into what that is a little bit. I'm sort of getting you used to the idea here. I don't know exactly how to approach it. Should I discover it as a principle of the universe, like a scientific principle, or rather should I try to sing in the chorus and try to tune myself into it? What should I do? And Lynn says, all right, okay, first of all, you've got to get the category straightened out. First of all, don't think in those terms. The comma is expressed, well, wait a minute, go back a step and think about poetry and think about music from the standpoint of poetry. Think about speech and think about the typical person who thinks today and the way, and from the way they speak, you know that they have no ideas. They're like the television news reporter. They don't have any ideas. Rat-a-tat-tat. Rat-a-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat. Rat-tat-tat-tat-tat-tat. Boop. Television reporter. All right.
And they throw in some BS, too.
Right. Now, what is different between human speech verging on classical poetry as opposed to written speech, recited prose? You have people who have eccentric ways in reciting prose, and they think that it's autistic. It's fashionable. You hear that on television. The television reporters, many of the reporters, these guys are idiots. They're just rattling on words. They're looking, they're just looking, right, like this, And they don't communicate ideas. As a matter of fact, they take pride in speaking in a manner that they don't convey prejudices, opinions. Rat-a-tat-tat, rat-a-tat-tat, rat-a-tat-tat. Beat on the drum. Not even rhythmic perfect synchronization. Metronomic synchronization, right? Rat-a-tat-tat. No rubato, right? Rubato is a sense of giving, if you want to put it. It means literally robbery, but it's a way of, it's the fact that when you're actually talking with somebody, if you're simply exchanging information, you're never going to exchange ideas. But a pregnant pause sometimes can convey a lot more than a million words if it's done exactly at the right time. It's the way jokes work also, too. So that happens then, is that in poetry, the art of poetry involves a singing quality. It involves irony. So take the simplest case of counterpoint. Let's take two-part counterpoint, just two element lines. Now, how do you do this? How do you deal with the relationship between these two lines, these lines of notes? Do you go note for note? Well, let's do that. Let's have Anna. Anna, where's Anna? Right. Okay. Do Jesu meine. Try it like that. No. Yeah. Yeah. But really, note by note.
Jesu meine.
Wait. That's a little bit too much. So let's do it. Good. Like Jesu meine Freude. Like that.
Jesu meine Freude.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Okay, now let me just give you an idea. She's not just doing it here. This is a well-respected chorus. Here, listen to this. All right. I'll tell you which chorus it is in a second. You'll be surprised. Right. In terms of doing this thing like this. No. It's okay. I think it's two. Let's see. It may be two. I think it's two. No, it's not. It's three. Yeah, turn up a little bit. There it is, right? Jesu meine Freude. Well, let's hear that again. I'll tell you who it is in a second. I mean, you have to be a little bit sympathetic. This is a recording of the St. Thomas chorus in Leipzig. But during the worst part of this is just about after the wall was built in East Germany, right? And I mean, you can almost hear the rage in the way they're doing it. I am going to fight this communist, because I mean a lot of the Germans hated this this communism that came down in East Germany at that point, and the Russians completely banned German music after in Russia after the war because there was this, and also there was of course a big pogrom against German, so-called German music in the West, put out by a lot of the Nazis who actually supported Hitler in America and Britain, because what they wanted to do is use Hitler as an excuse to stamp out everything that was good in German culture. They allowed the East Germans to as a one little scrap to continue to sing some of these Bach pieces, because Bach was a German. He was in Leipzig is in what formerly communist East Germany. So that's what you're hearing there. I mean, this was the same church that Bach taught at. But I can tell you that if Bach had heard that, he would have just said, "This is ridiculous." You know, I mean, that's not what I'm doing right now. But now we take. I'm going back to Lynn again, right? Let's do this. Let's take. Let's take the Anna and then the tenor. Right, where's that tenor? Right here. Okay, just the two parts. Right. But. Right. Okay. Ready?
The first one?
Yeah, do the opening. Jesu meine. Okay. Ready?
Jesu meine Freude. Meine.
Hold that a little bit longer, okay? Okay.
Jesu meine Freude.
Right. There's a lot of tension in that. I don't know if you hear that, but once again.
Jesu meine Freude.
Right. Do it note for note. Right? But
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Right. It's a little bit. You can see it's a little bit like what they were doing. Right. That's note for note. Thank you. Right. So you say. So Lynn says, you know, I mean, so how do you deal with this relationship between just two lines, the lines that we just heard, these lines and notes? Do you go note for note? Well, that's what the television speaker would do. Note for note, word for word, syllable for syllable. Or do you want something eccentric and fancy? You know, you can do something sort of wild. I don't want to give you, but like, Jesu meine Freude. You can do something like crazy, you know. But again, all of this is the question of what is the idea? The word Jesu meine Freude, by the way, means Jesus my joy, right? So, already you have an idea, right? Now, if I heard that chorus sing, Jesu, I wouldn't, and I didn't know German, I certainly wouldn't know that's what they're saying, right? Whereas in a poetic presentation, even if you don't know the language, you should already have a sense of what it is, right? Jesu, meine Freude, right? Jesus, my joy. You want to get that across, which is what we're working on with the chorus here. All right. So, do you have the relationship between? I'm going back to Lynn, right? Do you have the relationship between the two lines, not two different notes? In other words, how does the mind recognize a voice in a musical line where there are two voices? How do you recognize it? Because you express the voice as a voice, right? The mind recognizes this voice. And this procession of notes represents this voice. And this procession of notes represents this voice, voice number two. So it's the interaction between the voices which is the counterpoint. Right? Which is what a counterpoint, again, this is a bit of a technical term, but it means against a point or against a note, right? But the term properly conceived of does not simply mean creating chords or vertical relationships. You're actually creating what are called cross relationships in the voice. Like, for instance, when Anna did, right, Jesu mine, and then you hear it, Aaron go, Jesu mine, right, mine, right, that thing, and I had him emphasize that, da-dum, which emphasizes a cross relationship. And you actually hear that way, because you don't, people, unless you brainwash yourself, you don't generally hear chords. You hear, because you're not frozen in time. You're constantly moving. And so, despite yourself, you actually don't hear chords. And chords are kind of a thing that was cooked up. Were cooked up by an opponent of J.S. Bach, a guy named Rameau. I'll mention a few more things about him later on. So back to Lynn again. Sorry to keep going back and forth, but I think Lynn sort of, he sort of outlined this class for me, and I feel sort of obliged to continue with it. So he said, how do you do that? Well, there are many things you do, but you do it in a sense of irony, in classical irony, in a sense of metaphor. Right? Metaphor does not mean simile. It does not mean just this is like this. Metaphor is a higher order of things, which is a higher order of expression, which is gotten to by this idea of irony, treating things in an ironic way, but not simply in irony for irony's sake, but in irony in a way that gets, like a good joke, elevates the mind to a higher level of truthfulness. And you speak to convey a metaphor, not just to convey a word, but musically the line, the vocal line against line. Then you have certain points of intersection which are ambivalent. You might put in a third voice to make the thing work. Right? Now, when you put these things in, you actually are, well, forget the whole thing about vertical chords. Right? Chords like a jazz singer, the modern player. It's chords, 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 chords. This chord, that chord. It's actually discord, not this chord. Right. So therefore, you find communication of an idea, as in singing a song, so that the way you utter it is to convey an idea, and always to convey an idea which lies outside the ostensible dictionary meaning of the words that you are reciting. Because if you could interpret the line, dictionary word by dictionary word, there's no idea. Only when there's an irony, a contradiction, and a contradiction which has some real meaning. So you signal the one by the ironical way in which you speak it. So you signal the one in the way, the ironical way in which you speak it. Right? Right? That would be the news announcer. Right? Right? You signal to someone that there is an irony, and it has to be a real idea. It can't be just something that it's not just an effect. It has to be a real idea. All right, now fine. When you do that, then you get all kinds of problems, fun problems, which in the best example, that example of understanding of this is the work of Wilhelm Furtwängler in his conducting in Germany, especially his later work where he did something he called in words performing between the notes, which means that you actually modify the actual pitch, in which you have to come in, first of all, with a sense of perfect pitch, which is very useful to have. But now if you modified slightly that in order to, well, because one line is going in a different direction than the other line, and the relationship between them is ironical. Now, I just want to have something, again, let's play something by Furtwängler. Gives you an idea of what Lynn is talking about here. And then I'll play you another one by someone else, give you an idea of what Lynn is not talking about. I have it right here. This is actually, let me do it the other way around. Let me do it the way what Lynn is not talking about and then what Lynn is talking about. I think you'll understand it better that way. This is a very intense part of the Saint Matthew Passion from Matthew in the Bible. All right, and I'll just read the text here so you know it here. Wait a second. I think it's here. Let's see, do I have the text? No, it doesn't. Just a second. It's a very impassioned solo to Jesus, to the Savior. And it's done with an alto singing and a pair of flutes and pretty much nothing else. Let's do it first with another recording.
So who is this?
Oh, this is Conrad Richter. Carl Richter. All right. As I said, this is from the St. Matthew Passion. What this is, that's a commentary on the story. Sorry about that. That was a sorry to ruin that effect there. The aria is a commentary on the story of when the woman comes and anoints Jesus' feet, and the apostles say, "Why are you doing that?" You know, and Christ says, "Well, you know, the reason why is because, you know, the poor, you know, why are you dealing with this poor woman?" And he says, "You know, you're always going to have the poor with you, but you're only going to have me once." So this is a solo where she's commenting on that and on the ironies of that situation. Okay, and now I'm just going to, without comment, I just want to play the other one. You'll notice immediately the difference, at least some differences, but you may not notice all of them. As you can see, it's like two completely different conceptions of the same piece. Yeah.
Can you play the
Yeah, I will. I'm going to play the other one. Now, I want to point out, before I play it, though, that one of the things that he's doing, he's able to get this effect, is, first of all, I mean, you can tell that that has, I mean, I can't play the entire piece for you, but the Matthew Passion correctly done is an experience of a lifetime. It's hard to do. I mean, whole communities are required to do it because it requires two choruses, two orchestras, and so forth. And it actually should not be done by a concert choir. It's a kind of a community activity that should, if it's done properly. If it's done as a kind of a set piece concert choir, it never quite works, because it's got to be people who are really living through the Passion of Christ. You've got to actually live through it, and that's what Furtwängler is working on here, is allowing you to live through it and taking the time. And notice there are certain kinds of places where actually even the orchestra and was not together. Right, like at one point the downbeat of there, the flute, and then there's the pizzicato and the strings, and the flute and the pizzicato were actually not at the same place. Da boom, right, like that. And those things are not just mistakes. He actually does this deliberately. He does this kind of shifting, which I mean, a lot of modern conductors would say, you know, the guy's just a slob, and that they get irritated by it. But he's doing this for a purpose, and of course, other people would say, "Well, he's being, you know, this. It just feels funny, you know, because it's too intense. It must be Nazi. Must be Nazi because it's just too intense. You're not supposed to be that intense."
What is pizzicato?
A pizzicato is when you pull the string pluck the string without a bow. All right, you hear that? That's only thing that's going on is you have the soloist. And then you have the basses and the cellos are doing this little pluck every once in a while. And then the flutes. It's very sparse in terms of the orchestration here. I mean, I'll play you a little bit of the opening and you'll see how big this thing is. But you can see that you have to build the intensity of this. And whereas Carl Richter, who is a post-war, living in the post-war environment of the CCF, Congress of Cultural Freedom, which really downplayed any kind of intensity of expression, because that's just too Nazi, you know, too fascist. You know. You're not supposed to impose that kind of thing. Music is supposed to be nice, sound nice, and so forth, easy. Now, the other thing, though, he's doing is that, and it's a bit hard to hear, but the flutes, and we'll play both of them again, he tunes the flutes slightly flat. With respect to the orchestra and the singers. And that's another way that he's able to get that effect. And he tends to do this with the woodwinds in his orchestra. The symphony orchestra was a fabulous invention that was invented by a collaboration of Mozart and Haydn, and is a wonderful kind of extension of the human chorus.
So how does tuning the flute lower?
Yeah, it tunes the flute a little bit lower. It creates a kind of overall tension, which carries into the whole piece. Again, it's hard for me to describe this piece adequately with just one little piece of it, because it's like a 2-hour long experience that you have to go through. I encourage people at some time to really go through it. I'll make sure that people can hear the whole thing. But this is the kind of thing. It's a bending, kind of a bending, that occurs when you're properly doing a work of art, so that everything is not simply rectilinear and perfectly tuned. The idea of perfect tuning, that is, everything is absolutely perfect, a perfection of tuning, looked at as a static. Some kind of a static grid that everything has to match a certain pitch is not in keeping with a dynamic universe. Nonetheless, there are principles. There are harmonic principles. I mean, the planets go around in certain harmonies, and Kepler's work is very important about those harmonies. But they're metastable harmonies. Now, let's go back to the first one. Just see, hear it again.
Did they tune flat in the whole thing, or just the
excuse me?
They tune flat in the whole Passion? Just the
I think in the whole thing they're a little bit flat. Yep.
The whole.
Yeah. They're special flutes. They're what flautas are there, so there are these wooden transverse flutes, which had also were able to get this effect. Let's try it again. Okay, this is the Richter.
Gets over it quickly.
Notice that the flutes end, and then you have the then you have the, sorry about that. Uh-oh, wait a second. Wait. That's not too good. Okay. It's just a completely different order of ideas.
Was the delta singing higher too?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so.
One quick, but is he in 256? Is he in tune?
No. He's at the higher. They're pretty much at the higher tuning. That's sort of standard post-war. That happened to.
No, for Bangler.
Yeah, no, he was still the thing because all the instruments were at that pitch. It really had no choice. But anyway, to go back to Lynn, right? All real ideas are not literal. They are ironies, and they come from conveying paradoxes of speech as ideas. Right? As I said before yesterday, the universe is anti-entropic. The sun created the solar system, and it doesn't stop there. The natural tendency in the universe is for the universe to change itself, to proceed from a lower state of development and organization to a higher level. The function of language and art is to take words or to take music and to proceed from something which you think you know and say the right quality of performance is to go beyond the literal interpretation of what's before you and to recognize that the person who composed this work intended for you to recognize an anti-entropic aspect or implication of this. So now, when you do this, you come up with quasi-dissonances in counterpoint. And this becomes as many ways as you can demonstrate the comma, for example, dividing by thirds and so forth, or extending the chord. But the comma is never a simple number. It's an interaction among all the voices which come to an agreement. Now, we worked on this at the chorus rehearsal a little bit, and we're going to continue to work on these kinds of things, because what we've been working on some examples showing that, indeed, if you're singing properly with the chorus, if you have two voices, and then you do the same thing with three voices, and you do the same thing with four voices, you actually have to tune it differently. If you try to tune it absolutely, rigidly the same, it won't work. It won't have the proper effect. Let's get a little bit to just a couple of technicalities about this comma. Your violin is ready here? Where's Miwa with her violin? You got the violin? Can you get the violin out? Okay. So we can just so you have an idea, just some idea about what this thing is. You see, you have dead things, and you have living things, and you have cognitive things. Objects are dead. Things like musical instruments are dead. The human voice is living. So when you play things that are, and a long time ago there were some sort of preliminary discoveries around the tension between the living and the living things and dead things, and Pythagoras worked on this issue. A lot of people try to boil down Pythagoras by saying he just found the way that dead things vibrate in certain whole number ratios, like for instance an octave. Why don't you do an octave? Just play the open string.
A.
Yeah, play the open string, and then play the octave harmonic. Right. Okay. Now play the octave harmonic. That is, put your finger right in the middle of the string, at the octave harmonic. There it is. You haven't found it. It's not right there. No. Right
there.
Where is it?
It's not a half.
It's a half. No, that's not it. Here, let me do it. Sorry. Right. There it is. There it is. Okay. Here's. Right. See, that's the. And I'm dividing the string into half. And so it's a whole number relationship of 1 to 2. Alright. And if you divide it into 3. There. Hear that? Right. So that's an octave. That's called an octave. Right. This is generally known as a fifth when you divide it into 3, and you can continue dividing the string into various whole number relationships. You can divide it into 4, right? Let's see, let's try to 4. You can also do it down here. There's that one. Let's try to divide it into 4. I think it's about here. Right? Well, what? That's 2 octaves, right? Right? Okay. And you can keep going. Let's divide it. Okay, that's in 4. Let's do it 5. There it is. That's what's known as a third. 1, Well, the relationship between this. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit bad on this, but that and this. There it is. There it is. Da da. Right, that's your third. Right. Okay. So that's the relationship between four and five. Right, four to five. Or five to four, if you want to do it. All right. That's your relationship here. Now, all right. If you tune this perfectly, all right, let's try this, okay? Okay, now, can you tune this to a perfect fifth? If we can get this to work, right? Well, I'll try. Yeah, let me try. Actually, let's try this. We got to do an experiment here. All right. Let me see. Actually, let's do it this way. It takes a little bit of patience, but it's an experiment, a workshop. Yeah. Let's try. Save it. And then let me turn this on. Turn the microphone on. Now, let's see. We do it. We're going to see. Let me see. Are we on? No, it's not on. Where's that? Yeah, there it is. There we go. Okay. Let's play this one now. Let's see. Can it hear it?
Yeah. Where is it?
See, it's a little bit high.
That's above.
Gotta play it really close. There it is. You can hear it. Let me take this thing off. Maybe that'll help it.
What's it supposed to be? Oh, I think it was supposed to be.
Well, it's a little bit above that line. We're going to tune it down just ever so slightly. All right, we're going to try something here. Come on. There, that's closer. A bit down. Yeah, that's right on the money. All right, a little bit lower.
A little bit lower.
There, it's pretty much on. Okay, now. Yeah. Now I'm going to tune this top note, so it's as closely as I can to let's see. Let's play this top note. Yeah, look at that. Okay, there we got it.
Where is it?
Notice it's a little bit above up that line, yeah. Right? This one should be right on the A. Right, basically on the A. Right, this one. Well, yeah. There it is. It's actually there. You see it? It's a little bit above. That. That's a small, it's up above the line by a small amount, right? Mm-hmm. But it's a perceptible amount there, right? Now what this grid is this what's called an equal tempered grid, huh. Right here, What we're doing is we're measuring the steps here according to a system which was called equal tempering, right? Which, in other words, it's not the same as this. What was done is that in an equal tempered system, what's going on is that each of the intervals has been adjusted slightly. In this case, the fifth has been made ever so slightly smaller than the one that I've got on the violin, in order to make everything work perfectly. That in order to be able to get a scale that works, and in order to be able to go modulate through all the keys. I know some of you may not know a lot of these technical terms, but let me give you an example of this. I'm going to do it through singing this time to give you an idea. Right? Say you take your so-called Pythagorean natural third. Let's try dum. Let's see. There we go. Ni. No, that's too low. Ni. So you really got to work at getting it in tune, notice. All right. Okay. Now, ni. No. Na. Also, the problem with this is you can't vibrate. Watch what happens when I vibrate. Na. It's impossible, right? Right. But now, let's try. I'm gonna sing a Pythagorean third, right? Going up to Do Re Mi, right? So it's the C D to the E, right? Up to the E, right? Then I'm gonna sing another major third going E, F sharp, G sharp, right? And then I'm gonna give another to G sharp, A sharp, which they have here is B flat, and then it's going to go up to the high C. Okay, let me do it, but I'm going to do it with the Pythagorean thirds as opposed to your regular the thirds that are on this grid. Pythagorean thirds are a little bit larger. This is the relationship of 5 to 4, right? By a comma. But let me see if I can do this. No. I still got it. Yeah. No. Why is it not doing that? No. I'm still too low. No. Try it again. Let's try it another vowel. Ni, ni, ni. Notice the ni is a little bit higher than the E there. Right now, I'm going to start on there and then go ni, ni, ni. All right. Now, ni. See how high I'm above the C? Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Right? Those are your so-called regular, you know, your Pythagorean thirds. Now I'll do it with regular, with the so-called tempered thirds. Right? Ni. No. Ni. No. Ni. Vibrate. I like to vibrate, but I can't do it here. Ni, 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 ni. They're right on the money on that one. Right? Okay. Now, let's you can do the same thing with minor thirds and so forth. The point that I'm making is that this whole issue became this kind of this sort of phony debate that was raging that raged through many centuries of incompetent scientists, because nowadays, right, the people who say that music really shouldn't be a living thing and should be dead, what they do is they claim that that there's no issue at all here, because all you have to do is it's like the way that they teach calculus in high school. They just say, just forget it. You just find something that works and forget about all the little details. You just forget about it. It's the way that the delta is dealt with in calculus classes. And so they say that, well, look, all you have to do is just take the scale and just chop it up into equal portions. All right? That's what equal tempering is. The point is that indeed, this is the irony of the whole situation. It is true that in a dead musical instrument, you do need to tune it according to some scheme. And indeed, that one of the preferable schemes is something which is close to this kind of equal movement, but. When you're talking about a chorus singing, any good chorus, and not that many of them, but any decent chorus, and a string quartet will be constantly making these kinds of these little adjustments, a little bit sharp and a little bit flat here, because that's the only way the piece will work. So a lot of this debate was raging around the tuning of musical instruments, which are dead, and the people who get all tied into knots about this issue of the comma are the people who believe that singing is an extension of musical instruments, rather than vice versa, where musical instruments, properly looked at, is simply an extension of the human voice. If you're properly playing a musical instrument, you should sing on the instrument, right? You don't instrumentalize on your voice. The people who I got this crazy little book which is about temperament and tuning, which indicates the nature of the problem, which is that they it's sort of popularly written, and it's got all sorts of little zingers and one-liners, and it doesn't mention many of the most important aspects of the fights around science over the last 2,000 years. But just to give you an idea of this guy's idea about a dead, he says, well, look, the musical system should just be dead. That's all there is to it. You don't have to worry about it anymore. He says, all of this is possible, playing all these things, because the modern keyboard is the design of imperfect symmetry. Each pitch is reliably, unequivocally distant, equidistant from the ones that precede and follow it. This tuning allows a musical pattern begun on one note to be duplicated when starting on any other. Which, of course, is ridiculous, because the human voice is based on registers. So therefore, if you're starting on a different place, and even most musical instruments are based on registers, you start on a different register and so forth, then it's completely different, because you have a different color and so forth. I mean, there are all sorts of things, but he doesn't care about that. He just says it creates a musical universe in which the relationships between musical tones are reliably, uniformly consistent. Playing a piano, for which this was not true, would be like playing a game of chess in which the rules changed from moment to moment. Oh my God, can you imagine how disorderly that would be? Playing a game in which the rules are constantly changing? Wow, doesn't that sound like political action and the way you economies work and the way the reality works? You know, but no, it's too, that's sounds dirty.
Like,
you know.
Sounds like life in general.
Right. So, I mean, that's his take on this, and to give you an idea that I mean, through the centuries, a lot of formalist musicians have tried to take positions on the question of it's a kind of a phony debate, because on the one side you have the people, the so-called wealth equal tempered people who just say musical system is dead, and on the other hand you have the doctrinaires who say no, we have to preserve the purity of the Pythagorean tune pitches, that this is absolutely perfect, which reminds you of Copernicus arguing that arguing that the orbits of the planets have to be perfectly circular. It's the same kind of thing. And so you have this phony debate going back and forth, and various people took positions on it. Kepler was in his Harmonia Mundi was rightfully against, and he's against Galileo. And Galileo was the guy who was this hoaxer in Italy who did push equal tempering, and Kepler was rightly against it, because he said, I mean, God just would not, along arguing with Nicholas of Cusa also, that God would have, that any created object cannot be absolutely perfect. It has to have a disequilibrium built in to it. And he, you know, Kulze in his Ignorantia argues that you can't have a sphere that's absolutely a perfect sphere in the real world, because these things are created, and so therefore they have asymmetry, and everything is asymmetric in the way things work. And indeed, all the better musicians and the better composers would not really take a strong stand either way. They knew that they needed to modulate through all the keys. And Bach himself, just before Bach, there was a guy named Werkmeister. Werkmeister was one of the many who attempted to devise a musical tuning system for instruments that somehow would be able to deal with these, to make some kind of compromise, because Werkmeister agreed that there should be a kind of a temperament that is kind of a curving of the musical universe, but he didn't want to go to equal tempering, because he knew that that was totally, it's really arbitrary, and it flies against the way that a human chorus works. Bach himself wrote the well-tempered clavier as a way of showing that you could go through all the different keys, but he did not take a firm position on this side or that side, because all the smart people realized that it was a phony debate underneath it. Just to give you an idea of the kinds of things that were going on here, let me show you this picture. See, this here's a typical way that people were trying. See, people were trying to solve this by inventing all sorts of keyboards, where what you would have is, rather than your usual, you know, your black-white-black, you know, white-black and so forth, look at all these extra keys that they added. They're trying to add here in order to get every single of these various ratios worked through. I don't want to go all the details, but imagine trying to play something like this. It's extremely complicated. What's interesting is that Dr. Jonathan Tenenbaum recently gave me a paper by Max Planck, the famous physicist, who also was an accomplished musician and actually a composer. Only at the last minute he decided to go into physics. But he wrote a little paper about this, because he got his hands on one of these instruments and started playing on it and trying to tune his ear to be able to hear all these distinctions. But then he went out and this was in the late 19th century, around the 1890s or something like that. He went out, he had the good sense, being a good physicist, to go out and say, well, okay, all this is nice theoretically, but let me go out to Berlin and visit a whole bunch of concerts where people were singing, and I want to hear what kind of tuning the singers are using. And he was quite surprised at the results, because during that time, This was in a period of downturn of European culture generally, towards the 19th century, late 19th century, and then going into the 20th century, with the real collapse of classical culture and outright irrationalism, which of course the Nazi, the Nazi takeover was a part of that, but. There were a lot of people going around who were trying to revive these kinds of so-called natural tuning systems. It was the kind of a back to nature. It was part of the back to nature movement. They were saying we have to have these pure tunes. We need things that are pure, like this and this, as opposed to the dead equal tempering. And so people like Rudolf Steiner were pushing these kinds of natural tuning systems. The Theosophists, the Anthroposophists, and all these kinds of cults were coming and pushing these natural tuning systems. So Planck went out to Berlin fully expecting to hear all of these choruses singing in all these natural tuning systems, since that was very popular. To his surprise, he found that they were all singing basically well-tempered or equal-tempered, right? Despite all of this theory and so forth. They were basically singing equal-tempered, but with these adjustments working. So as I said, a good chorus will constantly be making these adjustments at any time, anyway.
What exactly is natural tuning? What do they mean by that?
A Pythagorean tuning, or various types. They developed certain kinds of systems of tuning. There are any number of tuning systems, basically in terms of how you distribute these commas, how you chop them up and add them or subtract them to certain intervals in the scale.
And the natural, it was considered natural because it just like left the comma.
Right. In other words, what they would try to do is like they try to keep the fifths and the thirds so-called pure, and then they would distribute and try to adjust the other parts, other intervals around that, so that what would happen is that you would get certain chords would be more harmonious. Whereas if you tried to play the same chord in another key, it would become a very, very disharmonious. If I had a keyboard here that you can have various tunings, maybe the next time we can show the way that works. But the underlying point that I'm making is that all of these conflicts come from the fact that people are not thinking properly about choral singing as the basis of singing, but rather they're thinking that of instrumental singing as the core, as the basic thing. So the question, of course, comes up, well, okay, well, now we've got this these pianos and everything now seems to be, many of the instruments seem to be, especially keyboard instruments, seem to be tuned in these equal steps. Well, what you find is that a good player, like Andras Schiff, who's Lennon LaRouche's close friend and is the best interpreter of Bach and also now Beethoven living today. Just a fantastic pianist, a wonderful guy. You find that if you listen carefully to what he does, he compensates for the... because he sings. He really does think singing in terms of his singing, and that was his training. He compensates for this fixed nature of the piano by doing all kinds of shaping of color and shaping of phrases in such a way of getting the effect of these kind of moving with the comma, moving by a comma, even though the instrument is actually not doing it. It's an amazing feat what he's able to do. It's an issue that most pianists are not even aware of. They don't even care about. They just play the notes. Only notes, please, you know. Just the notes, ma'am. And they just play on the keyboard. But he's actually playing he's realizing the limitations of the dead instrument, right, the piano, and trying to overcome those. The string quartet has it a little bit easier because the strings, you can, like here, you know, I have the strings tuned in a perfect fifth. Most string quartets do not tune in perfect instruments. They adjust their tuning a little bit in order to be able to get things right. But then, because they can move their finger they can always change the tuning slight in slight ways, and that's the trick of playing in a good string quartet, which is a lot of fun. Which is the closest thing you can have is working with a chorus.
So how does he do that? How does he make this coloration?
I'll show the next class. I'll try to give you some demonstrations of how he does that. Yeah, I mean, he just came out. He's coming out with all of the Beethoven sonatas now, one but in series, and so I'll do that another class.
Yeah, good.
Very good. Yeah, sure.
Two of them actually, and they have like three E's here on this keyboard in the top image,
right?
Or maybe even four, I guess.
The top one, yeah.
Yeah, to the left. Yeah.
Here. Yeah, look at this.
Those are just kind of off by what, a hertz, or what's the idea there?
These commas generally are about, if you divide the scale into, a half step into about, you hear this term cents, yeah. Right? And basically the way that works is that the entire octave is divided into 1,200 equal little increments, right? And so that then a half step is 100 of those little increments, or 100 cents. And a lot of the commas that you're talking about are around 24 cents, or 25, 23, 24. 25 cents. Some of them are smaller and some of them are larger. Mm. Because depending on which intervals you compare with each other, you'll get different kinds of commas. I mean, these commas just start coming out all over the place, because as I said, you're dealing with you're trying to do two things. You've got this idea of being able to move within a living musical universe, right? Which means you have to move through all these various types of tone centers to create all the maximum number of ironies that you want. The reason why you have different keys is not because you want to have something brighter and something darker. Right? The reason why do you have difference between C major and F major or something like that? I mean, why does a composer decide to do something in one key or another? Is it just arbitrary? Is it just because he feels like it? It might be because he has a singer whose voice particularly works that way, but in generally, the best composers decided to write something in a specific key because there are two main reasons. One is if they're dealing with pieces that have been written in the past in that key, and they want to create a kind of a dialogue amongst composers. So you find that, like for instance, you'll find that a lot of the composers who wrote Requiem masses would tend to write them in D minor, because it was a kind of a traditional thing that they would do. But more importantly, the reason why a composer writes in a specific key is because he's got a conception of how the vocal registers, or the mappings of those vocal registers on instruments, work together in order to create the effect of the idea of the piece that he's trying to get. And he has to organize the key in order to work with those registers. So he's thinking about how he's best able to get the ironies across. Let me give you another example of this adjustment of tuning, though, because this one is something that Lynn has talked about some.
One more question.
Yeah.
When you sang the notes, the microphone.
Right.
The first one you did, you called the Pythagorean intervals.
Right.
Now, those five, are like the string division intervals.
Yeah, 5/4.
And then you sang what you called the well-tempered
intervals?
This
is the equal-tempered.
Oh, you sang, okay.
Equal-tempered. Well-tempering is a funny term. You know, it's the well-tempered clavier. He adopted that term because that's what Werkmeister, who's a predecessor of Bach, right, but a follower of Nicholas of Cusa. Right? Werkmeister was invented his own tuning system, which wasn't equal-tempered. But it was a kind of an interesting compromise, which became sort of popular during Bach's day. Bach sometimes used it, sometimes didn't, as it suited his purposes. because he wasn't a doctrinaire on these issues. All right. And he, because the term was popular at that time, or was an interesting one, and there were a number of other people who were writing piece, who began to write these pieces that went through, that actually showed the possibilities of creating these maximum ironies with all the different, working with all the major and minor keys, or modes, is a better way of putting it. So that's where the term well-tempered comes from. And so let me play another example. Just it's a fun one, which is from a piece that Lynn has. This is the fourth piece from the Brahms Four Serious Songs, and it's a very interesting passage. And again, some of you, it's sort of this is brings in sort of this kaleidoscopic aspect that I was warning you about, because. You could give a whole discussion just of the four serious songs, but these are this is the 1 Corinthians 13, which was composed by Johannes Brahms, and the top the most intense thing is in the word Liebe. Or agape, because agape, love, is the most important of these, faith, hope, and love. And let me play, because there's one specific place, and I'm just going to play a little snatch. Sort of shame to do it this way.
What did you say about LaRouche in relation to?
What he points out is that in this, but this is a very interesting recording that was done in like 1953, which was just a few months before the great Wilhelm Furtwängler died, and a young baritone by the name of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau had been sort of adopted in a certain way by Furtwängler, and they worked together and on this piece. And you can hear the results of that work in terms of the way that certain things are bent, that is, things are not done in a totally straightforward way. In this particular piece, since this on this critical issue of Liebe, what happens is that this guy is a baritone. He's a high baritone, which means he's not a tenor. He almost sounds like a tenor sometimes. But he goes Liebe, and he takes this E and he actually makes it higher. He makes it brighter, but also the pitch he makes a little bit higher than it would normally be if we were singing it on the grid that I showed you. It makes it a little bit higher, and it creates an effect which is just quite amazing. Maybe we'll do the whole thing. Let's do the whole thing.
Can you do that one more time?
He takes on the word Liebe. It goes Liebe diesen Traum. Right, that section, you'll hear it again. On that top note, he goes a little bit higher. Right, it's perfectly deliberate. Right, he does that in order to create a kind of intensity on Liebe that otherwise you wouldn't get. All right. Let me hear that. Okay. Let's see. 1, 2, 3. Wonderful thing. This is the fourth of the four serious songs. Prophecy. knowledge and secrets. And I had all the belief that I could move mountains. And I didn't have love. I would be nothing. Nichts. I gave everything to the poor. And I burnt my body. And I don't have love. Darkly section. There's a modulation here. It moves into a different key. Something. You hear that? Right. Now, just as a comparison, I'm going to play just a snippet, and I'm not saying that the next singer is a bad singer. She's a fabulous singer, right? But she just doesn't do that. Okay, it's not her fault. I mean, because she wasn't working with Furtwängler at the time. Right. And she was in a certain sense she relied on her own good sense on how to do it, but she just didn't quite get this part right on it. She does a not bad job. This is Marian Anderson, right? And just the same little section. Let's try to get that little section to see here. Just I don't want to do the whole thing. I'm just going to do see if I can just get that.
Oh,
with something. Whoops.
Okay. Can I ask a question about the piece?
Sure.
What does it mean? For, I guess, the creative themes?
Hmm?
What does that, what does it mean?
What? Well, I think you can answer that.
Well,
you, see, you think you, no, I think no, that's no. A setup question.
No, no, no.
I mean, what does it mean? I mean, look, it's
or what's
exactly it's exactly this idea of a curvature, which is the dynamism, because indeed, love is not an object. It's a and properly love even amongst two people. That you love somebody not for what they are, but for what they can become. And that's why you also love humanity. It's the same thing. I mean, for crying out loud, you certainly wouldn't want to love humanity for the way it is right now. you love it for what it can be, because you see what its potential is. And all these other aspects of everything that you can do, right? You can have the greatest system, you can have the greatest system of belief. So I have my system of belief and so forth. I will even die for my system of belief. I mean, this is part of the problem with the way that the Muslims are being played right now. You know, I'm willing to die for my belief. Right? Whereas, and then you have somebody like the Pope who comes along and actually tries to have a dialogue. I mean, what they do to the guy? They try to cream the guy. You know, set him up for an assassination because he's calling for a dialogue. That's what's going on. So it is that curvature, that sense of a constant change and a constant development and a commitment to that.
We're having a difficult time hearing.
Sorry about that. Yeah. Can you hear it now? I'm speaking into the microphone now. Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. Sorry.
The microphone is suddenly turned into Verizon.
Yeah. I was just talking about the commitment. Question of love is really a question of not loving an object, not loving something for what it is, but loving for what it can become. That's really the only reason to love another person, and it's certainly the only reason to love humanity, especially at this point. So, in a nutshell, that's what it is. And you know, everything else is subsumed by that. And that's why Lynn is, and that's also what will save. That's the only way we can run a political movement nowadays. Because anything based on fixed sets of doctrines or anything will not work. We are a movement which is dedicated to sparking this kind of social interaction, and being a catalyst for this kind of social interaction, and that's why we're working on the singing so much, is because it's working through these kinds of matters in choral singing. That is one of the best ways of dealing with that, in addition to working it through from the standpoint of working through the great works of Gauss and Riemann and Kepler. Really working them through in intensive groups, and that's what we do, because that's this. We will have to maximize the intellectual ferment in these areas, and also, and I might add, we have to go this way and not sideways, as Lynn emphasized in some of his memos just today, when people were trying to say, well, we just have to do what we're doing, but we have to expand, we have to do all these different kinds of things, and there are all these wonderful things that we should be doing. And Lynn said, I mean, it's reading what Lynn was getting at. He was saying, we just don't have the resources to be able to do all these wonderful, nice little things. We have to focus on that which is absolutely essential and not get sidetracked. And that's why, you know, somebody brings up, why aren't we singing, why aren't we building our repertoire of, you know, all of these pieces? Why are you always singing that same old piece? Teresa Minor Freud. Well, you know exactly why, because this, through a process of dialogue with me and with Lynn and so forth, we came up with something that we sort of knew all along, which is that this particular piece was as if it had been written for our movement, because it's got everything you need to be able to get at these principles in a way that's practical for a group that we don't have an orchestra to do some of these larger works, where you could also get at it, but we just don't have the big orchestras and so forth. And eventually, we got to get there. But it's got everything there, and that's why I still haven't gotten tired of working on it, on this. And indeed, if you find, you know, most musicians, people who have decided they're not just going to sort of dabble in music, but really become something where they think of themselves as a musician, and I think you should all begin to think of yourself as a musician. I mean, amongst other hats that you have, that you find that the best musicians are people who do not sing an awful lot of pieces. They sing a few things, and they've worked on them for maybe 20, 30 years, and it's the basis of that handful of pieces, and the focus on that. That allows them then maybe at another time to start going out sideways. I might mention Andre Schiff, again, the pianist, because I mean, he for years all he played is Bach. He never played Beethoven. Never played it. He may have looked at it or something, but he actually never played it until about 10 years ago when he said, okay, you know, I mean, I'm 45 years, I mean, imagine he's 45 years old or something. He's never really even looked at Beethoven, even though he's the most incredible musician. Other people would have encouraged him to start playing the Rachmaninoff this and the, you know, the Liszt that and so forth. And he said, no, I'm going to focus on the Bach because I know there's something in here. It's absolutely essential. And then now he's able to come out with the most fantastic, incredible series of Beethoven sonatas because of that focus in his work. And that's the kind of focus that we all need to have in anything that we do. So I have other recordings. I could play all sorts of interesting things, but I don't know how late you want to go.
Is there a question for you?
You have questions or whatever.
Yes.
Okay. This is going to be hard, but can you give an example of why you would pick a key according to voice registrations? Because the voice registrations and the relationship to each other, that doesn't change. So why would you, how would one key bring out something more that you're wanting than another?
Well, a lot of it has to do with, and the best way to look at it is with things, which is the way the music manual that we wrote in the early 90s got at it. A very simple poetic device, that is what's called apposition. That is, you set simply, even in your statement, you have an opening, something that you say, and then you say something else which conflicts with the first thing that you say. Basic paradox. And any good poem should work that way. Any poem that doesn't create some kind of basic tension in its first opening couplet or first opening line is not, it's just doggerel. It's not really poetry. I mean, it may be well-meaning, but it's not going to give you a proper effect. And so, for instance, one of the ones aspects in the music manual we have is this. This piece by Verdi, Celeste Aida, on Aida, and where you have this, where is it? Celeste Aida, forma divina, mistico seto. Oh. Sanchez Gaida, right? And then Ancerto, which means mystical shield, right? Chedes de Aida, forma divina, means celestial Aida, divine form, right? And mystico certo, certo is the shield, right? De luce e fior, right? Of light and fire. And that certo, right, is a register shift, right? It's a vowel shift too. It's from a to o, right? Now, if you did that at any other pitch, like if I did it in a higher pitch, say I did it at, and it's an F major, right? Da, da, right? So that the F is supposed to be in the second register, and the next thing is an F sharp, mm-hmm, right? Which has to be the register. If I did take the whole thing up a half step, right? Let's see. Da, da. Celeste Aida, forma divina, mystico certo, di luce fior. You wouldn't have the same thing because both of those top notes are exactly the same. They're not in the same register, right? The Celeste Aida and the certo are both in the tenor's third register. And you wouldn't get that kind of that kind of apposition. Mm-hmm. So in simple things like that, it's and you know, if it that's an in usually when the composer is working these things through, it's not just a simple apposition that he's working through. He's got much more complex, you know, series of things that he's working with. Like in the case of the Chedis de Aida, right? He wants to go up to the very high B flat at the very end, and he knows that the B flat of the tenor has a very specific quality that some of us have been working with now in the lessons, that every single when you're singing bel canto, you find that every single note is slightly different. They're not equal, right? Because there's whole different geometry sometimes that you have even inside the same register. You have to do something different, and the B flat is really different than the A or the B natural. He knew that he wanted to get that right on the B flat in order to get the right effect. So that's just one example of how that works. There are many, many. The music manual has a lot of examples in it that show these kinds of selections that go on with good composers. Oh, you want to hear really bad? Here, listen.
No.
Yeah. No, you don't want to
hear. Yes.
No, this is interesting.
Put something good after.
Yeah, I'll do something good. This is like an example of a bad choral singing. It's like the best example of bad choral singing. No. This is worse. This is actually a German. Again, this is this East German problem, which is that this is the Mass in C, Beethoven Mass in C, and it's like the chorus is like wallpaper. I mean, it's shocking. I'm gonna play a little bit of it, not a lot of it, just to give you an idea of how not to have a chorus.
You might have to quit the program.
Which chorus is it?
It's in Leipzig. Again, it's not the same chorus that we heard with the Jesu meine Freude, but it's I think it's called the Leipziger Chorverein or something like that, the Leipzig Choral Society in Leipzig, with the so-called Gewandhaus Orchestra, which is the main orchestra there. And the funny thing is that the soloists are actually pretty good. The chorus is terrible. And it's just this East German problem that you come up with a lot.
Thank you.
singing there? Absolutely no placement. No support. Right, the solo is separate. Sound.
What piece is that?
That's Beethoven's Mass in C. And they're moving it much too fast.
Right?
It should be. Right? They're doing. It's just this la di da di da di da stuff. So it's just give you an idea of the problem that you have of people who do it. One of the problems is, and this comes back to this Richter recording that I played of it, is again, it comes back to this question of instrumental music, which Lynn has emphasized time and time again, right, about the fact that music is choral and vocal primarily and not instrumental. Richter was an organist. Right, that was his background. And a lot of what's happened is that they orient, they try to make the chorus sound like an extension of the organ. Rather than doing the kinds of thing that Schiff is trying to do, is that what you do is you take your dead instrument and you try to make it like the living. They try to take it like the living and try to make it like the dead. No, it's just typical of these guys. Okay, now you want to hear? Okay, here. Okay, let's see Kurt Fengler conduct it. Right.
Oh yeah.
This is some video of Kurt Fengler.
Oh, that's
conducting. No. This is just some a little bit of. This is a little DVD. This is actually what I'll do is I'll counterpose. Again, Kurt Fengler conducting with somebody who's doing something, a dead man, I mean, walking, which is Toscanini, Arturo Toscanini, and you'll see, it really, this is quite shocking, you'll see the difference. Rim little man. Oh, shoot. Oh, well, for you guys, I'm going to sacrifice. I guess I'll do it. Or wait a minute. Do I have this?
It's online.
No, but I've got it on the list. I really don't want to have to do that. Wait, where's my computer bag?
It's underneath.
There it is. I think I have this.
You know what that driver region code thing is? Is that for the disk or is it for the computer?
Is this from a different country?
Hold on.
You can only change the drive region code 4 more times.
Right.
My God.
Yeah, no. Stupid.
Oh, you're gonna, oh, good.
Oh, I may have another way of doing it. Hit was. I know. Wait a second. Wait a minute. I got another idea. Wait. This may work. Yeah, I got VLC player. With this. I think VLC will do it. I hope VLC will. There it goes. Got it. Did we get it? What happened to it?
Pythagorean comma have to do with the arithmetic geometric mean?
Gauss. It's Lynn. Wait, Lynn is dealing with the Pythagorean comma. His non-formal way of dealing with the comma in terms of the way that I can't answer this completely, and I'm still sort of working it through, but. But this, God, how do I put this in words? You get at it with this idea of the a pitch which seems to have various tunings depending on how many voices they're singing. Think about the arithmetic gene, because the arithmetic geometric mean is not a number. And it's actually a process. You can't give a number to it. Right? It's not a number, I mean, per se, at least from my understanding of it. And it's exactly the same thing with the way that you, I mean, as we were working in the rehearsals, the way you get a particular tuning of a note, right? You move in on it when you add voices, you make the adjustments, and you get it there. But it's not actually a frequency that you end up at, especially because the voices are vibrating, and they have a color. So you're getting there, right? but it's not a point on a line. That's the best thing that I can say at the moment on it. I'm still, as I say, I'm still working on it. We had some preliminary discussion with Bruce Director on this very, very question, and we need to have some more discussion on it, I think, in order to get a better beat on how to talk about it in a productive way. But I mean, my sense is that the fact that Lynn thinks that I'm on the right track in terms of the working on these choral tunings indicates that I think we're getting there on figuring that out. Yeah.
I have a few questions. I guess I'm still, investigating and trying to understand music itself. So one of the questions that I think, one of the things I don't understand is when we reference the motet and said that we should look at it vertically versus horizontally.
We shouldn't look at it vertically.
Okay. The other one is not. It should be looked at horizontally. I don't understand what that means. From what you were doing with the chorus today, is the idea to get at motion itself, just to kind of keep everything just flowing, just keep it moving? And then my second question is, you said earlier today, with the idea of tuning, I kind of got a sense of it's more with what you were going through tonight. But isn't that what every choir does? Don't they at least, make sure that every voice has the exact note? And then they're all at the same, there's a certain distance on flat, and they just keep it moving like that. And so what exactly do you mean? Like, we're the only ones that goes after the tuning, really, and then the other ones just don't. Like, what do these other choirs do if they don't necessarily do that?
Okay. We're dealing with our chorus. Let's dash the second one first. With the chorus here, and the choruses in general, we're dealing with... like a triply connected process, because on the one hand, you've got people whose voices, voices can still have trouble for physical reasons getting the right pitch. Right, so that's the first thing. I mean, that is even getting an agreement amongst the section to get the right pitch. The next issue you have is the one that you mentioned, which is this question of, just getting it sort of so that it sounds nice. Right? So it sort of sounds, and basically what you're talking about is getting it more or less equal tempered.
Yeah, just
in that
to make
way.
Sure that...
But then the next step, and this is the one that we've got to do a lot more work on, right, is then you take that and you adjust that and you bend it in order to get the overall effect of the piece that you want. We've gotten, I think that when I'm listening for what the chorus has in the intonation, I'm trying to think of all things on all three of those levels simultaneously, right, as much as possible. Sometimes it seems like I'm just going through the second one, as you mentioned, right? So I can see why it's a valid thing to bring up, because sometimes that's what we're simply doing, is trying to get it right. But as I say, my intention is to get it to that third level of this extra. Once you've got that, then you make the extra shift from the standpoint of the way the entire piece works, not just the section of the piece, but the entire piece.
And then to go back to your first question, on the again, it's a question of it's like what Lynn said here, you know, where he says, where does he say this? He said something that struck me.
Is it about the vertical horizontal?
No, no. He says here. He says, but the problem here, this was at his birthday thing. He says, the problem is your sense of identity. You see, it's not what you do that is important. Now, that's important, but what you do, if it's the right thing, doesn't work unless you have the right sense of identity. All right? And he says, in order to be successful as a scientist or an artist, you have to be immortal. No, immortal. What does it mean to be immortal? Is mankind immortal? Is there a difference between mankind and a beast in that respect? No animal is immortal. Right? They die and that's it. And the only way that an animal achieves any immortality is through a relationship with a human being. And he moves along that line. So it's this question of not so much what we're doing in some of these cases, but it's the question of how we're doing it, how we're approaching it, and what our intention is. That's gonna make the difference in this. It's the same thing with these things. Sometimes, yes, it seems like we're tuning chords. When I'm stopping things, we're holding things, so we're getting just right. But I can tell you that what I'm attempting to do with my limitations, with your limitations, mm-hmm. is to be able to get to that extra level along the lines that I was discussing here. Right? Make that extra shift. Right? Once we've got it, you think it's just right. It may be right locally. And again, think about that thing with the Furtwängler, slight mistuning of the flutes, these kinds of things. A slight change of tempo from the standpoint of how you want to get the tuning, a slight change of color in order to have how to get the effect of the whole piece just right. Now, we haven't even gotten, I mean, in many cases, in most of the cases, we haven't reached the level yet, and I would really like to do this, and I know that's what Lynn is champing at the bit to get this, so that we have enough mastery of all of the sections of the Jesu Meine Freude, so then we have the freedom, mental freedom, and it's a social thing, it's not just me, but everybody has the mental freedom to be able to run through the entire sequence of pieces of the Jesu Meine Freude. You can actually do this as a mental exercise. Has anybody done that?
I've done it.
You just sit there and you think through the piece. Right? Section, 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 section. See, you know what follows. Obviously, you have to know what piece follows what. But then you try in your mind to actually think of it as a unit, conception. Right? Maybe jumping around. Maybe taking mentally the last and the first piece and then working inwards. And taking the two trios, I mean the two trio sections, the Dindas Gazettes and the Zoaba, and working outwards and inwards from there, which I think is the way Bach thought of the piece. And then what we do is, well, once we do that, and we're able to do something like that, we can shape the entire piece. And then, so even though maybe some of the tunings that we've arrived at so far, we may have to make further adjustments on it from that standpoint. I'm certain of it. Right? If we're doing it right, that's where we're moving towards.
What are some of the things that from that standpoint we should be looking up for the?
Hold on one second.
What are some of the things then that we should look out for? I'm asking for myself in terms of the motet. You know, we've been working on it for a few years now. I know the majority of the tenor voice already. I know a lot of the bass voice and it's part of the second soprano. So I'm still trying to learn like a lot, just all the different voices of the motet. Like I said, I'm still beginning to in this investigation of the music. The other day when we had a quintet, it was a few days ago. I understood something that got me very excited when it was Anna and Ardina, and it was just the women that were singing the Essays Nuniques, and as their voices mixed, there was like a type of note that was produced with the mixture of the voices. So So I found that pretty interesting. But what exactly, like, is that one of the things that we should be listening out for when we're listening to these different voices, when we listen to the motet? Or, like, what's some of the specifics that we should be kind of getting to know?
Well, what's important is not to listen for the mix, but to also work, listen for the critical cross voices and try to identify those mentally. Right? In terms of, I mean, as again, the way I always point it out is the opening. Right? Right? With the cross voice, with the soprano and the alto and the tenor. Right? With this Lydian double cross voice that occurs there. Right? The soprano goes, Jesu my, and then the alto, hi, which is the Lydian, right, and the D sharp. Right? And the same time with the tenor going, my. Right? That double in the one voice, whereas it's going across the soprano and the alto. And it's working those kinds of critical cross voices in some of the other pieces. You can do it in the Dendes Gazettes section, is very good. Some of the pieces, unlike the Trotz, is a little bit more difficult from that standpoint. The Trotz is rather vertical in the way it works. But it doesn't completely work that way, because Ich stehe hier und singe, right, as we know, and as Lynn has pointed out, and as Jean Seb has shown, you've got this tension that's built up in the Ich stehe hier und singe. Right? So I think the thing is to identify these critical nodal points in each of the sections. There's still a lot of work to be done on the Gute Nacht und Wesen to figure that out. There's a lot of work on the Zoava, which is technically the hardest one, and the one I haven't pushed as much, because it's so technically difficult for the poor tenors. Although we'll get it. We had a question here on the phone. I'm sorry. Interesting. I have to think a little bit more about. Have to think a little bit more about that. It's obviously, some of the pieces he doesn't do that. He doesn't do that in the chorales, for instance. It's all one soprano. I don't know whether he has a. I just have to think about that. I promise I will think about that more and actually come up with something which is more thoughts on why he would select that. I think in this particular piece, when you're dealing with a piece with which does not have an orchestra in it, There's certain kinds of requirements that a lot of times you need five voices and not four. Another interesting aspect of that is like sometimes you do double the basses, by the way, in the B minor mass, Bach's B minor mass, in the second Kyrie, you have the bass going, doing the fugal subject. Kyrie eleison. But what's interesting is that the double basses and the cellos are playing a completely different line. It's a four-part fugue, you would think, because the only four parts of the chorus are singing, but the orchestra is actually doing a second bass line as well. And so that I think that's why, I mean, many, not all, but many of Bach's motets are five voice and not four voice. Because you need that extra, without the instrumental, instrumental voicing, you need that extra part in one way or another. That's about the farthest I want to go in the moment on it.
Hey, John?
Yeah.
How does Bach use the well-tempered clavier to show that he can use a piano for well-tempering? Is that what he's doing?
Well, yeah. I mean, the idea there, I mean, on the most basic thing, is that if you did not have some kind of tempering principle which was on your instrument, if the instrument was not tempered in some way, either with... in some of the more sophisticated, either equal tempering or something more, one of the more sophisticated compromise tunings like Werkmeister's own, his so-called well tempering. If you didn't have that, you would end up in some of the keys that he writes in, like in key of F sharp major or something like that. It would sound absolutely horrible. I mean, you can demonstrate this. If some of these electronic keyboards, you can actually change the tuning to Pythagorean and Werkmeister and so forth, and you can play around with these things. I don't know whether the keyboard that you've got can do that.
It can move down very small steps.
No, but the one in the DC office, they've got one, and which you can actually change the tuning, and you can test this out for yourself. You can try to play in these different keys, and they sound right. They sound crazy because some of the intervals are wildly off. And so, this cycle will only work if you're playing it on an instrument, which is more or less the way a chorus would work, as opposed to with one of these more primitive tuning systems for an instrument.
Some of us have had a look at another version of the Yzerman Freude by Bach de Huda.
Right.
Could you give us an overview on that? Like,
no, you guys have looked at it more than I did. I found it, but I sort of handed it over to you guys to look at, to have fun with. So
you want us to sort of look into it?
I should have some fun with it. I mean, I know that in Boston they've done some work on it. They've sung through it and sung parts of it. And Matthew described it as like doing archaeology, because it's so obvious that it was helpful for me just in looking at the score. I actually didn't sing through it. I just sort of looked at the score before I handed it on to you guys. Is the way that he handles the word nichts, right? So that in the very opening chorale, right, he has rather than nichts sonst liebes werden. He has nichts sonst liebes werden. And of course, you can just hear Bach coming up and listening to that and say, oh, yeah. Right? Oh, I know how to handle that. Es ist nun nichts. And even though that's Paul, right, that's the Paul, that's not the chorale, that's Paul, right? So you can think of Bach saying, how do I get that nichts? Oh, Paul.
you can almost hear him trying to figure out how to put this thing together as at least part of an aspect of it. That I found quite fascinating. But there are other aspects I know that they've looked into in Boston.
I've noticed that that Felix Mendelssohn has a Deus Manifredi too. Have you heard of that at all?
No. Yeah. No.
Okay. It's a cantata, I guess.
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. It's about like Bach's method. Like, because I've been recently working on just some of his cantatas, just listening to them. And I found the end chorale of one of these cantatas is basically the same soprano line with like one difference of the Jesu, and it's called Unter deinem Schirmen, and it's the same words, but it's
right.
Different. It's in a different key.
Right.
And I think the tenor line's different, and the soprano line's different. They're both, there's a lot of differences, but I can tell that it's the same chorale structure. And I've heard other things too in some of his cantatas where I hear like bits and pieces from his organ works and things like that.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering like how would you go about compose, is that how he composed? Like he would just continuously take things.
Look
and
at the way Lynn writes. I mean, you know, look at the way Lynn talks. Look at the way Lynn writes. I mean, isn't it, I mean, is a perfect example of the creative guy. You know, Lynn's right, you know, how many times has he written about our immortality?
Right.
In how many different ways? And in some cases, the phrases might be exactly the same. But again, the work is different. Or sometimes, when he's speaking, you could tell that he's practicing for an article that he's writing and so forth. It's very clear. Mm-hmm. And some of these things that Bach had to write, I mean, he had to grind these things out.
Yeah, every week. Yeah.
So, I mean, you can imagine in certain things, he's saying, okay, well, I'm going to use this as a practice or a warm-up for something that I'm really interested in. That's just part of the way that's the part of the creative mind's workshop.
That's what it was,
it's the way they're working. You know, and so it's just way people work. Good people are working. You work in somebody, you know, go into a great painter's workshop and so forth, and he has millions of different sketches of the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, some of them he works up, some of them he doesn't, and so forth. Lynn has constant all sorts of drafts which he never publishes, and he writes some of them he burns up and he throws away. Other ones he writes and he puts in the table. The things that incredibly as it seems, the things that end up being published and even in the briefing is only a part of all the things that he's writing. It's just incredible.
He's a busy man.
Yeah, it's just amazing. But that's just the way the creative person, you know, works. And I mean, we're really privileged to have somebody like Lynn to really get, I mean, who's a living person, to see how that's working with somebody who's with us, as opposed to sort of having to study with it with somebody like Schubert or Mozart and so forth. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How's the Pythagorean comma like paradoxical?
Because it creates this tension between living things and dead things. Mm-hmm. That's the way I look at it. Mm-hmm. Right. The issue comes up because there's some people who are offended about the fact that there's a difference between, rather than looking at that as a way that a certain aspect of God's create of the creator of the way of the creator's wisdom, right? That we have this multiply connected universe of things that are dead, living, and also then cognitive, right? They view this as very too messy. So what I'm trying to get at is this thing. There are two ways of looking at the Pythagorean column. There's the comma. There's the formalist's way, which is say this is something that's messy, and we'd rather just sort of we wish it could go away, but since it can't, let's chop it up into as many pieces, equal pieces as possible, and then sort of forget about it, and act as if it didn't exist. Or what Lynn is trying to bringing up, which is the thing that since we are living in a living universe, that therefore you can't just wish it away, that there is this tension between those things that are dead, non-living, and things that are living, and that there and since in a certain sense the universe is made up of combinations of those things, and in our case we've got instruments which are dead things,
right? And human voice, but human voices primarily. But then we've got these, we've invented these instruments, which at this point are dead things. Who knows? Maybe we can invent living instruments at a certain point. I don't know.
I guess it's interesting,
you know.
I don't really understand what it is.
What is?
Pythagorean.
Well, as I say, what we're getting at is that it's not an object.
Well,
right? It's a concept.
It's a relationship.
Right, it's a concept that we're trying to get at in terms of a way, an attitude towards how you look at the fine tuning of a chorus.
So would you say it's like a mean or?
Well, no, because it's a way of, it's a kind of, it's the ironical way in which you have to treat tuning, issues of tuning, rather than thinking that somehow you're going to arrive at some kind of perfection of tuning, right? Which is the standard way that people nowadays are trying to talk about tuning. They get it just perfect, right? But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about something which is, I mean, to give you another example, take this guy who's talking about equal tempering. Again, go back to this quote that I gave you. Right? Because this guy's a liar. Right? Because he says here. Right? Well, he says here, right? I already read this quote, but it's important to go back. He says, that on the piano, modern piano, each pitch is reliably, unequivocally equidistant from the ones that precede and follow it. Now, actually, if you told that to a piano tuner, he would shake his head and say, that's insane. Because any person who even tunes a piano knows that depending on the type of piano, and this is just that you read the manuals, I mean, you know, I don't have to go very far, depending on the kind of piano, whether it's a grand piano or an upright piano or a spinet or every kind of piano, you have to bend the tuning slightly in the upper and the lower reaches of the piano. You have to tune. You can't, if you try to tune a piano totally linearly, according to the, you know, some machine or so forth, the piano's going to sound out of tune. Because even though it's a dead instrument, it is an instrument that has wood and various types of things resonating, and so it does create a kind of dynamic process, and it's well known that if you try to, so that therefore even there's even a curvature in the tuning of a piano. So this guy's just crazy.
Okay.
You know?
So why the word coma?
Well, again, I mean, Lynn is using this as a way of creating a kind of resonance around the paradoxes of the issue of the coma that's come up, because indeed, what we're doing a lot of times when you're making an adjustment is you're adjusting by one or another types of these commas. And as I said, you can from a number standpoint, you can, depending on which interval you counterpose with any other interval, you can have millions of different types of commas. And Jonathan Tenenbaum a while ago wrote a paper where he actually showed that you actually get a manifold. If you think of all of the commas that you get a manifold that's everywhere dense. And it's because you have an infinite number of these commas that come up.
What was that? What was the paper? Was that?
It's a private paper. I have it on a PDF. I can make it. I've made it available to some people, but I can send it. It's a thought-provoking thing. He wrote about 10 years ago, which recently we dragged out when we talked about the comma. And it's a useful first approximation of talking about these matters. But it's as I say, it's sort of preliminary at that point. It was never published or anything. Yeah.
Hey, John?
Yeah. Phone first. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. Hey, we went to an exhibit up here in Oakland recently on Paul Robeson, and it had a snippet of an interview that he was giving where he was discussing chorale. He was actually comparing African chorale in their development up to what he called just a pre-Bach standard, and then comparing that to certain 13th century Czechoslovakian chorales and then talking about how in his recitals he would do, he would be doing, I forget if he said it, he was doing Negro spirituals and then he would insert Bach, or he was doing Bach and then he would insert a spiritual. But he said he would do it because it fit, it belonged there. And I was kind of blown away because I didn't think that anybody besides Lynn really talked about these things. And I was wondering, I don't know if you've heard this from Robeson, or I was just wondering if you would have something to say on that.
Well, people who did a lot of work on that, he did work, Roland Hayes went to Africa and did a lot of original research on that very thing. And also Bill Warfield, who was younger, picked up on that. And they were all very interested in this question because they were working through African heritage. My sense is that a lot of these things that ended up in Africa through all sorts of devious routes originally came from Europe in one way or another. I think the argument that somehow some of these things that they came up with were indigenous, I don't think holds a lot of water. But I think that they were, I don't think they were really, from what I understand of, and you know, when I've talked with Bill Warfield a little bit about it, I don't think that they weren't trying to use it as a kind of a, you know, Africa has great classical culture too, kind of argument. But they were just doing it as a way of trying to settle certain things in their souls about where they came from, which is sometimes useful. I've heard some of this stuff that they've talked about, and indeed it piques one's interest. That's about all I can say about it. I mean, I don't think it's something that you want to sort of get yourself engrossed in, because again, as I emphasized before, Lynn is really focused on making sure that we don't go sideways, because there are many, many fascinating byways off the highways that could be explored, and we just have to make sure that we don't waste time on exploring them, which would be very pleasurable, a lot of fun, but we don't have the time to do it.
This is a trap.
Yeah, right. No. Well, let me read you something here. This is about Newton. According to Newton, man is not inherently musical. According to Newton, natural singing is the sole property of birds. In contrast to our feathered friends, humans perform and understand only what they are taught. There's your British.
That's it. That's totally in opposition to St. Augustine.
Right. Now, let me mention something about another, you know, idiot, Descartes. Right. So really, René Descartes had a tin ear. The preeminent philosopher of the early 17th century confessed that he couldn't hear the difference between the sounds of a fifth and an octave, or judge whether someone had sung a scale correctly. That's also the case of Helmholtz, by the way. Helmholtz was totally tone deaf.
No way.
And he had to rely on this guy Ellis, who was also pretty tone deaf himself, in order to write his stuff. These great scientists who, you know, supposedly.
Did you hear that? Yeah, I heard it. I think so.
Is that it?
No.
And now Rameau.
Please.
Rameau's the great proponent of chords, the existence of chords and bass. He's the one who said the bass line, you know, you've got the bass line, and that's the bass note is everything, and then you've got to build the chords on top of it, and that's really all it is. And he said that he was interested in, and this is what they all got interested in, is the harmonic frequencies of metal objects that are banged or you know, even strings or something, but any metal object that's set into motion, something that's dead, that's set into motion, you know, and he noticed that the lowest sound of the whole body is what sees your attention. And in fact, he asserted this is why equal temperament works. Although on the surface, its altered proportions may appear to tarnish nature's perfect intervals, in truth, equal temperament shows that the ear depends upon this fundamental bass, the lowest tone of the sonorous body, dead body, right, to guide it. Once it perceives this foundation, it understands intuitively the relationships that are intended between the musical tones that sound above it, right, i.e. totally vertical sense of so-called music. These are the real idiots on this thing. I thought that was interesting. Apparently, equal tempering was, and this is something you might want to look into, actually. According to this book, you don't want to get too distracted by side things, but according to this book, the term equal temperament was actually discovered in the West. And there was a Chinese guy, an emperor, Chu Tsai Zhu, in 1584, who also invented something which is almost a perfect equal temperament. But in the West, it was a guy named Simon, a Dutch engineer by the name of Simon Steven, Stevin, who was a hater of Zarlino, who was one of the better musical theoreticians, who Beethoven really liked. And he wrote a treatise, which is called, Arithmetic, and where he said that, get this, right? He said, when you have an equal tempered scale, it's the increments are the 12th root of 2, right? Because you have, if your basic tone is 1, and then your top note is 2, right, so you're going to have to be going by equal increments. So each increment is the 12th root of 2. And he said that there are no absurd, irrational, irregular, or inexplicable numbers. Okay. That no number can be said to be more beautiful or divine than any other one. In other words, what he's saying is that there's no ordering principle of higher orders of numbers at all. Everything's just completely flat. The world is flat. Geometry. Right? So I don't know who this guy was, but he apparently was a real hater of probably one of these Newtonians. And he also said that the big problem is the Greeks. You know, they were at fault. The messy Greeks. Right, who brought this up? And he said here that the problem with the Greeks is that they spoke Greek, and that he said that in his view Dutch is the only language which is suited to the science of nature.
And the Dutch Empire.
Therefore, it was easier for him to find. It was easier for him, Simon Stephen, to find nature's true tuning. Right, which he did through a simple mathematical formula. Isn't that wonderful?
LaRouche references what you did on September 5th, probably on the East Coast.
Right.
I was wondering, is that recorded somewhere?
Yeah, it's on the web. It's on the LIM website. Some people have
it. Computer over there.
Yeah, you got it on the computer. Yeah, it's just, as I say, I've done some of the same work here that I'm doing, although it was a good recording, and so I sent it off to Lynn to see, just to ask him whether I was on the right track or not. Well, thank God, phew! He said I was. So.
Is there music written in today, in equal tempering? Is it all equal tempering?
Well, there's not much stuff that's deserving the name music that's being written right nowadays. If it is, it probably has gotten shoved off into a corner because people are just. Anything that with ideas, I mean, if you go to a conservatory and you try to write a piece that has ideas in it, you're not going to last too long in the conservatory. You're going to go to another subject. It's bad.
I mean, these different composers at the beginning of the 20th century, at the end of the 19th century, like these.
No, there are not that many. I mean, you know, he had, you know, Brahms. After Brahms, he really didn't have any. He only had one sort of student, a guy named Gustav Jenner, who wrote a very interesting biography of Brahms. Jenner did compose. I've listened to some of his compositions, and they're very modest, and which is good. He wrote modestly, and the problem is that he lost the connection to Bach somewhere along the way. They're sort of nice, but they don't have this Bachian type rigor that you find even in Brahms. See, some people like to think of Brahms as writing all this romantic stuff, and you can hear a lot of that. You know, people try to write like Brahms, but they never really are able to do it. Because Brahms was coming from a different place, and although a lot of what Brahms does sounds very rich, and indeed he has a lot of incredible dissonances in it that you can only really get at what Brahms was doing if you do it from the standpoint that Brahms himself was doing, which was this incredible commitment to Bach and also to Beethoven too, and both of them. So I don't know of anybody else. I mean, you know, there, who at least a major composer. But I say there may have been people who were writing stuff all along. But I don't know. It's this kind of thing. You know, writing compositions is a very delicate thing. It's a very social process. It's not when you're writing compositions or poetry, really good poetry, you can't just close yourself off in a room and sort of start writing things. It doesn't work that way. It's the result of a whole social process that encompasses everything that you're doing. Your friends, your family, you know, the political situation, the entire thing. It's an incredibly rich and fine web, society and social relations. And so, if you don't have the right mix, it's virtually impossible to get a composer into this shape to write things along the lines of ideas. Very hard. It's like poetry. I mean, we don't really have any great poets either, and exactly the same problem. Poetry's really fallen off. So, that's why we have to concentrate so much on creating the youth movement and the way that we interact. Chorus, so we're trying to create, seeing if we can create that kind of dynamic with us in our dialogue with everybody else, because we can't just do it with ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, and create that. And believe me, I mean, if Lynn sees an opening for any kind of compositional work, he sees something that it's effective that won't be a sidetrack. These people have brought up with this, why don't we just have a group, why don't we go off and have a composer's work group or something like that? And it says, no, it's a total sidetrack. It won't work. Because we don't quite have the right dynamic. And so it would be a nice thing to do, it would be the wrong thing to do at this point.
Okay.
But, I mean, if you have musical ideas, and you have things that you've got knocking around in your head that you want. I don't think you should not put them. I mean, if you have things that you need to get out, you should put them on paper. I don't think that people should sort of cut themselves off and say, I'm not, you know, Lynn says we shouldn't compose anything and so forth. If there are things that you want to get out, by all means, do it. Mm-hmm. And show it around and show it to me and so forth. But just don't make a shtick about it. We've had some problems, and that's been a problem in Europe. Where people have sort of gone off on their own way in the organization among the boomers. People have sort of gone off on their own ways and so forth, and it's got very chaotic. Some people have actually gone off and composed a lot of stuff, but it's never had that something that is something that spark. It's just not quite there. every once in a while there have been a couple pieces. Jonathan's written some pieces. Werner Hartmann has written a lot of things, some of which have a little bit of a possibility. But again, it's the social process is not quite right there, so it's not surprising that they haven't come up with something something really that we can go with. I think that things will arise out of the need to do more singing and so forth. I mean, there are plenty of things we need. We need more pieces for a cappella chorus along the lines of what we're doing. There's not that many really great pieces for a cappella chorus. And we can't just wait around for an orchestra. So those are things that need to be composed, just for starts. We're doing canons and so forth, but some good songs of our own composition would be good also, rather than just doing lyrics to other songs. But again, if people have some, I'm always open to people's ideas about this, but it's got to be a social process, not just walking, putting yourself into a room. So I think everybody, it's like the Farewell Symphony, one after the other. Right?
What about tempo in terms of conducting Bach's, or the, is any Bach, but the Jesu, what was his intention that you know of considering tempo changes in verses like what Lynn's talking a lot about rubato?
Rubato, it really isn't a tempo change. Mm-hmm. Rubato is a thing that you do within a tempo.
Mm-hmm. Right? It's more of like a yeah. Bend the breath or something.
Well, you actually, I mean, specifically, the best thing to do is if you rob from one measure, you want to take it back from,
right.
Give it back in another measure, mm-hmm. or vice versa.
Yeah. Because someone around here, I was talking with one of the sectional teachers, and he was saying that he was reading Casals on Bach, and Casals' view, according to this guy, was that there isn't a lot of tempo changes. That Bach would have not conducted with tempo changes, but would have used the like things like the breath or the maybe these kinds of devices more, the hesitation and
sure. A lot of things
the time.
A lot of things can be done. It's amazing what can be done with color and coloring the voice, articulation in combination with registration.
Right, that was the kind of stuff Casals was saying.
And so forth. Absolutely. So yeah, a rubato, that's why a rubato can never be arbitrary. Right. You really need it, you should do it, but no, you can't get into a habit of doing rubatos because that doesn't work.
I used to think that the trots, like at the Ich der Hirn singen, when it goes to the Ingarzisch part, mm-hmm. I used to think that Ingarzisch part was supposed to slow down a lot.
I think it should slow down. I think it should slow down some. I do.
So there is a...
Yeah, and then it should pick up in the Gottesmacht. I think that's just the way it happens, yeah. I don't think it should be a strict tempo.
Mm-hmm.
And the Ich stehe hier und singe. I think here is very important. Tolbe Welt und springe, right? Let all the dead instruments, right? Rage around. I stand here and sing. So I think it's a critical place. And we can, as I say, we can do some interesting questions even on the tuning in there. But I haven't really thought about it.
You know, in the Bach's Tehuda version too of the Trotz, it's a bass aria.
Right.
And the bass does sing a very similar line of
mm-hmm. Well, it sort of calls out for that.
Yeah. Mm. Right?
Why do the nations rage together, shake, and the Messiah. Does the same thing. It's a kind of, shake, the voice shakes and so forth. We do those kinds of things. So externally, it's just, I wouldn't make such a big deal about it. I mean, it's just anybody who is sort of having fun composing, they would want to do something like that.
So it makes sense that they would do those things.
Not Kruger, though.
Yeah.
The original him, he doesn't have
Yeah, you're right. That's very...